गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन. प्लीज जस्ट कंफर्म इफ माय वॉइस इज ऑडिबल टू ऑल एंड माय स्क्रीन इज विजिबल.
13:14
एवरीवन प्लीज कीप योरसेल्फ ऑन म्यूट. Yeah, okay, great. So we'll start with the session. So first I'll give my introduction to you all. So first of all, I want to greet you, greet everyone that you have connected to us. So good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Rupesh, I'm the host for today's webinar, which is on Microsoft Azure Administration AZ-104 certification. So we'll start with the introduction about today's session. Before moving ahead, I would like to give a small introduction about our today's sponsor, that is Synergetics. So Synergetics is the India's one-of-a-kind corporate learning solution company, which helps any industry to get their relevant technological solutions and helps to be on top of the competition. We are not only restricted to group trainings, but also our Microsoft certification trainings helps every individual professional to succeed in this competitive world. Here are some of the master solutions offered by Synergetics. As you can see, onboarding solution, rescaling solution, certification solution, certification plus add-on solutions, cloud adoption solutions, architecting, practice playbook, latest technology training, and emerging technology trainings. So today's webinar is organized by ATC community and sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. Our ATC community is open for all the people who are interested in Microsoft cloud technologies. You just need to follow up our meetup groups. Which are emerging technology community, Azure Tech Community Pune, Surat Emerging Technology Community, Azure Tech Community Nagpur. And people who are interested in artificial intelligence, they can follow artificial intelligence AI on Microsoft platform community. All you have to do is just install a meetup application in your phone and you can follow us by searching with these names. So this is our code of conduct for today's webinar. Please note that you cannot take the screenshot or you cannot do the screen recording. Our recordings will be shared in the on our YouTube channel. So do follow us on YouTube. We'll be sharing all the links in the chat box. So you'll also get this YouTube link in the chat box. Do check that later. So there's one more thing I want to add. So today I want to share an important message with you all. Recently, there was an incident happened during a webinar. There was an attendee who is also an employee of a well-reputed company and contacted some of our other attendees from the webinar and he offered some job options to them. So guys, please take a note of this. We have already blacklisted this person, and if anything that will be violating our policies, we'll be facing strict legal actions from this time onwards. I will request you all to join our session with the learning purpose, and please do not mix such activities which are unprofessional. So let's move ahead. So our agenda for today's webinar is manage Azure identities and governance, implement and manage storage, deploy and manage Azure compute resources, configure and manage virtual networking, monitor and backup Azure resources. Our session takeaways are getting inside to implementing, managing, and monitoring an organization's Microsoft Azure environment. So our today's speaker is Mr. Om Prakash Pandey. So Om Prakash sir is highly experienced Microsoft certified trainer with decades of rich experience in technical learning and implementing consultations across India and the globe. His teaching experience spans across more than 50,000 students and 200 enterprises around the world. Currently, he is working with Synergetics as an AVP of delivery department. Now you can grow professionally by adding the latest technology skills with Microsoft various certification. You can enroll for any of these training programs with Synergetics, where you will be experiencing live interactive sessions with the best industry and Microsoft certified trainers. Trust us and we'll deliver the best. So This is our webinar calendar for the month. Sorry, this is our training calendar for the month. So anyone who's interested in any of these trainings, they can just contact me. The number will be shared in the chat box. The same number is available on the WhatsApp. That's a Synergetics official number. You guys can contact me and I will share the appropriate dates with you. So this is our yearly webinar calendar. Our next certification webinar that is happening on 14th of August. The time will be in the morning, 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. It is on introduction to Microsoft Compliance Solutions. SC900 certification will be covering the topic. Anyone who's interested in it, in this technology webinar, they can register themselves. We'll be sharing the registration link in the chat box. Yeah, and the next webinar series that is simultaneously we are running with certification webinar, that is ETT, Emerging Technology Training Webinars. So the next topic for this is the next webinar is happening on 21st of August. The time will be in the morning, 10 a.m. to 12 noon. So the topic is Jakarta EE9 specifications for NoSQL integrations and designing enterprise web services. Where we are covering Java technology. So to attend this webinar, again, the link is shared in the chat box. One special announcement, as your feedbacks are very important for us, guys, please do share your feedback. We'll be sharing this feedback form in the chat box. There's a link for that. So based on those feedback forms, we'll be selecting 5 lucky winners who are going to win the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers with which you can attempt an examination. So please do share your feedback. So now I would like to hand over mic to Om Prakash, sir. Thank you everyone once again. So you can continue from here.
Hello and good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible to you all?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So let's get started. Thank you very much, Rupesh, for the introduction.
Welcome, sir.
Do let me know once my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible now.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining. I know Saturday is a rest day for most of you all, but still you all have sneaked out time to invest in your further learning. So taking ahead from what Rupesh mentioned rightly, I'm pretty sure everybody has been through such kind of links in past, which shows how extensively Microsoft is spending and creating huge number of available certifications on different areas. So whether it is Azure Administrator, Associate, that is AZ-104, the current paper that we are going to discuss about, or it is from development perspective, on-premises implementations using Stack Hub, right? Azure Security Associate, that is AZ-500, right? Papers for artificial intelligence, data engineering, DevOps, specialty of solutions in terms of SAP or WVD. Everyone, please keep yourself on mute. So most of you would have been through these kind of certification papers. So depending upon what is the job role that you are into, there are number of pre-existing certifications given by Microsoft. Thanks to Rupesh, Manish, and the entire marketing team who have been trying to reach out to maximum of audiences, showcasing what we are capable of. And as part of Synergetics team, and as part of this team, I lead this team from front. I'm a AVP delivery at Synergetics, and I'm also a Azure architect certified on number of these papers that is being mentioned over here, whether it is Office 365, Microsoft 365, Azure Stack, Power Platform Resources, So depending upon whatever might be your requirements, you can connect back to us. Manish and Rupesh will assist you in terms of where are the next set of certification courses that we are launching, and they will guide you accordingly. As I keep discussing about these things, I will keep putting these links on the chat window. You can take a look at it. Out of all these papers that we have, right now we have selected one of them, which is AZ-104 Administrator. As far as this paper is concerned, this is primarily targeted towards people who have already been working with on-premise resources in terms of virtualization, in terms of virtual machine administration, people who have been working with number of virtualization platform solutions like Hypervisor, VMware, System Center, vCenter, vSphere, right? VirtualBox solutions. So people who have been working on these areas, have experience and expertise on these areas, it becomes easier for them to latch on to this course, understand about the deliverables, understand about the components over here, and see how it works on a cloud platform. If you look at the course details, right? So already Microsoft has mentioned about what is the right kind of profile, user profile that should be there, right? What will be the skills that will be measured, and what are the key areas of focus that you all would have during the exam? Based on my experience, let me share it with you all. The paper is slightly lengthy, so it requires good amount of expertise. It needs good amount of expertise. It needs great amount of practice. Because if it takes time for you to, everyone please keep yourself on mute. Rupesh, can you help me with this? I'll take up the questions at last. I'm sorry. Right now I would want to complete the discussion. So as part of the paper I was mentioning about, the paper is quite lengthy, so you'll have to be quick enough to understand the scenario, right? You should be able to understand the components involved within that scenario and should be able to quickly respond to it, right? So that's a very important aspect. There are quite a few questions which would involve experience and expertise on PowerShell commandlets, Azure CLI, working with Azure portal. So there will be number of questions where the screenshots will be given to you all and saying, and the questions relevant saying what will be the impact of this, right? So if you, what will be the right option to choose from if you have to satisfy a given, if you have to solve a given problem, right? So most of the questions which are being given are scenario based questions. And that's the reason why I'm mentioning it again and again. It requires a thorough practice, right? Now, if you look at the core topics over here, one of the most important aspects, that is identities and governance. Here, there will be questions based on Azure Active Directory. Please be careful. There will be questions over here which will be from Premium P2, right? I'm pretty sure y'all have started working on it. If not, you can go ahead, create a free trial or attend one of our courses where we can offer you Azure Pass. Thank you. Where we can offer you Azure Pass, and using this Azure Pass, you'll be able to explore the entire environment for a month's time, right? And you can schedule your exam accordingly. During our course, we make sure all these modules are being covered smoothly over there. And one of the important things that you'll see is Azure Active Directory. So as part of Azure Active Directory, and I was mentioning about premium P2 licenses, so that you can check out for advanced features in terms of configuring AD, Azure AD join, configuring self-service password reset. Apart from this, the common aspects also you should be able to work with. In terms of premium P2, there are a lot of advanced features, right? And some of the questions are based on those advanced features. So you can, once you have the Azure subscription, you can go ahead, get a free trial of premium P2, assign it to specific users, and then start working with it, right? That's how you can start with identities. Another one that you see over here is management of subscriptions and how do you configure governance of your environment, right? So once it comes to subscriptions and governance, this is barring the exam, that is one important aspect. Apart from that, even in day-to-day life of an administrator, this becomes very, very critical. How do you manage the subscriptions? Because if you're aware about it, once it comes to subscription, the subscription is like a tap. It's and what flows out of it is not the water. It's actually the cost which you are paying for consuming these services, right? So how soon or how quickly you want to spend all that money, subscription can behave as a tap for it, right? So it is important to have checks and balances. It's important that you shut down the resources or govern the resources in such a way that you only have required resources being created, right? What are the best practices for subscription management? What are the best practices for governance? These are certain things that we cover, which are more relevant from a real-world implementation perspective. Before I forget this, if you look at your course and the starting entity over here, everybody can go to this link. And if you all scroll down, you all will be able to see number of free courses over here, right? Which I would recommend everybody to go through. So in terms of prerequisite for Azure administrators, your identities, management of storage. So every aspect that I'm mentioning about, all these things are available as free courses from Microsoft, right? Now the obvious question over here is, Om Prakash, if these courses are for free, then why should I attend any other course from any other organization? Maybe Synergetics or maybe any other XYZ institute. As far as these courses are concerned, these are providing the base background. They don't go into too much of details and they don't share some of the industry experience or best practices which is required for day in, day out tasks which an administrator is supposed to do. And that's what is specialty at Synergetics, correct? So what I recommend all my participants before they come to my session is, have you already gone through these online offerings or online courses which is given by Microsoft? Okay, because this will help you lay down the foundation. Another thing which I like over here is, most of these modules that you'll see, they already specify the scenarios. They specify how this entire resource will work. What are the options available here? Correct? So like I was mentioning about scenario-based questions, some of the sample scenarios you'll be able to see over here. That is what makes these courses special, right? So this is online free courses available on Microsoft Learn. And by doing this, Microsoft is ensuring that they are doing their bit to build the basic foundations for learners. I've already shared the link on the chat window. Let me proceed ahead and get into more details about the modules over here or the skills which is being verified. Now, next important member that you'll see over here is handling the storage account. Now, as far as any of your resources are concerned, and it's nothing to do with the cloud environment as such, even if you look at your on-premises environment, even as part of on-premises environment, we are focused on three important aspects. One is compute, second is storage, and third is networking, right? So even if you're working with System Center, Hypervisor, VMware, or any such resource for that matter, all of them are focusing on these three core components. Especially once it comes to virtual machines, the VHD files have to be stored somewhere, right? Now those VHD files or the content that you are storing over here, whether it is file share, SMB components, right? All those resources are being saved onto Azure Blob Storage, right? And this is one of the most important aspects. If I'm not mistaken, around 25% while I was giving my exam, around 25% of questions come from storage account. And at times, some of the questions may not be directly, but indirectly associated with storage account. So you have to be very, very careful where we'll have to practice about number of resources within storage account, understand the scenarios, and then choose the right set of options when you are giving your exam. In real world scenarios as well, some of these storage components that you have, they are associated with NAS tokens, which is shared access signature. And using this shared access signature, we are able to allow access to a given individual or group of individuals based on the timelines, based on their IP address, right? Based on what permissions or what restrictions you want to enforce, correct? So there are a number of attributes which incorporate or which we are able to enforce over here by using these SAS tokens. Along with using SAS tokens, we can also enforce these kind of restrictions or provide these kind of permissions by using Azure AD authentication. I don't have to mention it. If you see the module one where we began with Azure Active Directory, here you have it associated with Azure AD authentication for our storage account. Right? Along with that, once you come to storage account, apart from creating new contents, you can migrate or move some of the content, copy and paste some of the contents to your storage account. So when you're talking about backup services or file share resources, right? So all these components, you can move it into storage account. Now, as far as these skills are concerned, how do we cover these skills during the session? So for that, we have a complete course being recommended by Microsoft, which is a 4-day training, right? 4 full days, where we teach participants how each of these things can be implemented. And again, you'll see over here, you have series of prerequisite modules of Azure fundamentals, which people have to go through or people should be aware about. So it becomes easier for people to learn these things, right? Now, before I proceed ahead, can I see raise of hands? People who have cleared AZ-900, Azure Fundamentals. So Nachiket says yes. Superb. I can see plenty of them who have cleared AZ-900. Rishi Mishra, okay. Kaveri, excellent. So I can see around 13 to 14 of them who have cleared their AZ-900 certification. That's really, really good. This lays out the foundation for AZ-104. I can still see there are plenty of them who have not cleared their certification on AZ-900. My request to all of you all would be, please look at the entire course go through it, because AZ900 is not specifically about a specific type of audience, even salespeople, pre-sales folks, right? People who are from finance background and are moving towards cloud, because today cloud is become a necessity everywhere. Huh? So it is very, very crucial that everybody begins their journey, and the foundational journey begins with AZ900. So if you I can still see a lot of them who have not worked on it or not aware about it. You can connect to Manish or Rupesh for a session from our side, right? Or you all can go through the Microsoft Learn resources. This will help you lay down a strong foundation. Now, once this foundation is being done, then covering the infrastructure topics in these 4 days becomes much more easier. Otherwise, while you are within these 4 days, you'll see there are so many bouncers going over the head. What is happening? Om Prakash is just teaching these topics, but we are not able to grasp it. Correct? So that should not happen. Not just that, even if you go to your online courses of 104, like I mentioned earlier, even there, it should not be a problem. So I would recommend all of you all to complete this course from Microsoft Learn or from wherever possible to help you have a strong foundation on what is cloud all about, why cloud, what are foundational services on Azure environment. So those things you will be able to see over here. Correct? And then you'll realize that out of the large platform that we have, we are focusing on certain aspects over here, like storage, networking, identity, virtual machines. Correct? But the fact of the matter is there are a lot of resources on this Azure platform. There will be a lot of requirements and expectations from various users. They will be having their expectations from the cloud platform and how Azure can fulfill those requirements. Okay. Everyone, please put your hands down. Everyone, please put your hands down. Amina, Rahul. Thank you. So can I see raise of hands? People who are from AWS background. Okay, so Nachiket, Raj, Amina, Jitendra. Great. So there are plenty of them who are from AWS background. Again, AWS is people who are not aware about it. There are plenty of resources that you have in Azure, which are also parallelly available within AWS. Obviously, the names will be different, right? But if you look at the implementation areas, like you have virtual machines here, there you have your Elastic components, right? You have S3 storage, right? So similar options that we have within Azure, we also have on AWS. And to be more precise, AWS is the one who took the initiative, who started with cloud computing much, much earlier than Microsoft. So earlier we did not have anything as Microsoft Cloud. It was AWS who initiated this journey. But since they had a different kind of audience with them, and that's how the entire product got crafted out. So entire Amazon as an organization was more towards e-commerce. So entire cloud got initiated from supporting e-commerce perspective, right? So how do we quickly create virtual machines, get onto the market, scale those resources, create reliable resources. But once it comes to enterprises, Microsoft has more reach and more depth as far as enterprise requirements are concerned, from security perspective, compliance perspective, right? And if you see the number of compliance certifications, these are maximum once it comes to your Azure environment as compared to AWS. And in terms of competition, if you see, both of these are, Microsoft is a organization which is IT driven. They were already into many such enterprise products, right? Much before AWS was, because AWS directly started on with cloud, whereas Microsoft had these products available in the on-premises environment. So what they did is, once they had their cloud platform, they started creating all these things as services. And you'll realize, and within no time, all the products which we had within on-premises environment, given by Microsoft, given by open source systems, given by third-party partners, everything is now available on Azure environment, right? So initial, yes, it took some time to come up the curve, but starting year 2012, right? Microsoft has taken the entire lead as far as the cloud space is concerned, and they are still focusing on number of IaaS services, PaaS services. With Office 365, they are also into SaaS world, where AWS is still not there, right? So if you look at the spectrum of services or spectrum of resources offered by Microsoft Azure, or I would say Microsoft solutions, it is much, much bigger as compared to what AWS is offering. Now that's one aspect of compute solutions. But if you look at helping users to move on to Azure environment, there's a separate course for 2 days, which is targeted towards AWS specialists. Right? And here we can see one-on-one comparison with AWS resources. Like very rightly mentioned, EC2 instances. So what are the options available? Mapping to each of these members in terms of storage accounts, in terms of file share. So whatever you all have been doing, or whatever AWS team members have been doing, right? How do we achieve same kind of thing on Azure platform? So it's more of, I would not say it's new learning. I would say it's more relevant from mapping perspective, mapping or creating a similar kind of solution which exists in terms of AWS on Azure platform, right? So we can assist you in these solutions as well. We have specialized team members who have certified, who have done certifications on both these platforms, especially once it comes to administration. Now, while we talk about these implementations, we should not forget about multi-cloud solutions today, right? Number of organizations today are not just looking to work with a single vendor. They're saying, if that one vendor goes down or there's some problem on the vendor side, how do I make sure I'm able to serve my customers better? Keeping that kind of requirement in mind, what I would suggest as a consultant, as an architect myself, is people should be certified with number of platforms. So you should be certified on Microsoft Azure if you are already certified on AWS, right? If not, at least you should have required knowledge on Azure front and AWS front as well. Even people who have worked with Microsoft resources, we can assist them for AWS resources or AWS infrastructure solutions as well, right? Because it becomes easier for us to learn via comparison. And the most important thing that you'll see is, so whatever I mentioned right now, how Microsoft is scoring above AWS, unless you all see it yourself, try it out yourself, how do you know that, right? You can't go to a customer saying that, since Om Prakash said that Azure is better, I'm saying the same thing to you. It doesn't work that way, right? So you'll have to show some of the examples, create some of the solutions, bring out your bill of materials, bring out the resources, right? And show some of the implementations, how the costing, how the product resources, how the performance. And these options are much better in a new environment. So I was working, I was mentioning about storage resources. Moving further with that, like I said earlier, that once it comes to AZ-104, AZ-104 is more about administration, product management. So here you all can see deployment and management of Azure compute resources, right? So when you talk about compute resources here, we are referring to virtual machines, right? And as part of virtual machines, there are, or I would say, before we get onto virtual machines, there are a number of entities over here where you need compute resources, the computational power that you need. So a vendor which provides more set of options in terms of range, variety, right? Different set of simplified management solutions, right? That makes our life easier as administrators, okay? So once it comes to Microsoft, just give me a moment, everyone. Let me take you all to a very, very crucial resource over here. So there's a separate section over here called as Azure Documentation, right? And even within that, you have something called as Architecture Center. Within Architecture Center, you can look at something called as Compute Service. And there's a very simple and elegant diagram which I would want to show you all. Here, if you all see, it clearly mentions about what should be your approach, what should be your approach over here once it comes to compute resources. So as part of compute resources, if you're going for complete, if you're going for lift and shift, that is migration, but I don't want to go into re-architecting right now. Re-architecting, we'll do it later after we have studied it, after we have understood it correctly. But right now, just do a lift and shift. Move whatever is available within the on-premises environment. So you're doing this lift and shift. Do you have a containerized application, non-containerized applications, right? So based on that, you can go for Azure App Service, you can go for virtual machines, correct? In terms of if you need a full-fledged orchestration for a containerized application, then you can go for Azure Kubernetes Services, AKS. You can go for Azure App Service Containers. So here you see for each of these actions that needs to be performed, in which scenarios, what would be the reasons, what would be the purposes, and under those scenarios or for that specific outcome that one would want to achieve, what will be the options available here, right? But if you see the variety of options available, virtual machines, Azure Batch Service, depending upon how much control do you want, what are the options available, what are the requirements that you have from the customer side, based on that, we can take our decisions over here. So these are the options that we have. And you'll realize most of these compute options that we see are more from administration perspective. So if somebody's from development background, say React.js, right? Or open source resources, open source development, correct? So what is the role that you are in? What is the current role that you are playing right now? So if you're into developer role, I would recommend go for AZ-204. If you are into, like I said earlier, virtualization roles or system admin roles currently, go to AZ-04, AZ-104. If you are from database side, you have relevant set of papers, like I shared the link earlier with you all. So there are, if you are from an artificial intelligence background, you have a separate set of certification for it. So earlier, there were hardly 3 to 4 certifications only. I do realize that a lot of people who were not from that background, even they had to appear for that kind of certification. But with the new releases, as far as AZ certification are concerned, from last, I think, two or more years, correct? Microsoft, once they have released these separate set of tracks, right? People have been getting or specializing into those areas, getting deep dive into those resources. So doing their conceptual learning, doing their respective implementation over there, right? And that's what is helping them to speed up. That's what they're helping them to go deep dive rather than learning a lot of unnecessary things that they were doing earlier. Okay. So as you all go ahead, you all will be able to decisions correctly. And depending upon what is your area of interest, what do you want to specialize into? Based on that, you can choose your certifications. You can choose your learning options over here. And we are standing behind you to help you guide the entire implementation, help you help and assist you in your learning process, in your certification process, right? And that's what we do these sessions for. So people can come ahead, ask their questions, and we can help them to understand what is the basic certification details over here. So Manish and Rupesh, they would have already shared their details with you all in terms of email address, their phone numbers. You all can connect to them, right? And we can organize sessions for you all on specific topics, whether it is certifications or it is specific areas of concerns or questions that you all have. Now, you all will realize that out of the entire diagram which I showed you, some of the implementations is being done over here in terms of virtual machines, configuration of containers using AKS, configuration of app service. So these are set of resources that we have within your compute options. From networking solutions, here we have configuration and management of virtual networking, right? So here if you all see, again, around 35%, or I would say even more than that, around half of the paper that you see is virtual networking. Now, why am I saying that? Because virtual network forms the foundation for every resource, whether it is storage, whether it is compute, whether it is security, everywhere you see significance of virtual network. And people who are from admin background, they would also definitely know about the significance of VPN, significance of networking, right? Even if you are part of the physical networks, even there you will be aware about the significance of networks. Because unless we lay down these foundations, we cannot have our machines or your virtual machines, physical machines or virtual machines being configured on top of. Any kind of communications that we are looking at, all these communications inter-system communications, all these things happen via virtual network. So if I'm able to talk to everyone, if Manish or Rupesh are able to communicate with you all, because everybody has an identity. Everybody is identified by a specific name. All of you have logged in using your machine, right? Or your device into the system, right? That forms the foundation for our communication. Same thing holds true as far as virtual network is concerned. So as part of this virtual networking, here we have implementation and management of virtual networking, where we have a range of IP addresses which your machines can use. So there can be a private IP address. There has to be a private IP address, and you may or may not associate a public IP address depending upon whether you want external exposure or you want to share your resources with other team members, customers directly, or you want it to be accessible only to internal consumers or internal customers. That's up to you. So if you look at the options available here, access to your virtual networks, how do you protect access? So one is enabling access and second is restricting access. So I would want only relevant people. I would want relevant members. Correct. I would want to open only respective ports, which is mapping to my applications to be opened for communications. Right. So these things we need to do as a administrator of Azure environment. So once you have set up this entire environment, we can take care of monitoring, backup resources over here. And finally, once we have set up this entire environment, we can monitor these resources by using Azure Monitor. So many a times, as an architect, I would have, or as an infrastructure person, I would have promised a number of things to my customer that this is what we'll achieve. This will be the performance. Right, you go to cloud, we'll show you stars over there and all those things. So we may have promised a lot of SLAs, a lot of things. Is it actually working? If not, what is the problem? Because cloud has enormous amount of resources. If something is not working as per customer expectation, what is the reason for it? What is going wrong over there? So some of these things we can clarify. Some of these things we can verify by going to Azure Monitor. Since I was talking about SLAs, what if the underlying system goes down or it is not responsive? We can't leave our customers high and dry. So what we have to do is we'll have to create us BCDR solutions, Azure backup, Azure site recovery solutions to make sure if the primary site goes down, secondary site is available to us. Right? So these are some of the core modules, which is the focus area as part of your AZ-104. I'm not sure if this PDF is visible to y'all. Let me share this URL once again. So here, if you all see, this is what I was mentioning about. So even before you latch on to AZ-104, start working on it, some of the basic information or basic details is essential. If you are hardcore into this background and you want to get from a long run perspective, you would have, if you have already been certified on MCSA Windows Server 2012, 2016, MCSA on core infrastructure. Right, so these are some of the foundational aspects, or you can go through Azure fundamentals. Like I mentioned about, there's a self-paced online course, which I mentioned earlier. You can go for AZ-104 administration, which I've been talking about right now. I showed you two resources in terms of Microsoft documentation, Azure Architecture Center. So these are pre-existing set of links which Microsoft offers to make sure y'all go through, then y'all should be able to understand the complete journey over here, how these things work, what are the options available, and what is the next step after this. So once you are certified on AZ-104, y'all can go ahead with migration of applications, right? You can go ahead with DevOps, depending upon what is your role right now within the organization, right? And what is the future roadmap which is being crafted for y'all. Right. So based on that, you can continue further with other set of courses. As part of today's session, I would quickly want you all to take a look at the most important module, which is virtual networking, which is one of the sessions that we do as part of the entire course. So just want to give a glimpse of it in the limited time frame that we have. Now, first thing that you'll see over here, as part of every module, not just about this one, every module that you'll see, there are respective labs over here. These are Microsoft provided labs where you may not have what do you say, screenshots for each and every aspect, because today sharing a screenshot can become dangerous with the speed where the technology is changing, the resources are changing, correct? So what Microsoft has done is they have clarified saying these are the steps that need to be done. And for performing those steps, one may use PowerShell, one may use CLI, one may use a portal. So in each of these cases, these are the steps required. Go ahead, perform these steps, and you'll get your resource ready. So that's the approach which Microsoft has taken. So every module that you'll see, there will be a respective lab over here. And even before when we, like I said earlier, even before we start the session, we share details with participants in terms of Azure Pass, right? We share required MOC, Microsoft Official Curriculum, right? So that the knowledge part of it gets covered, the implementation part of it gets covered. And during the session, like I said, sharing of real world experience gives them the needed skill to perform the activities and work with required resources. In terms of components that you'll see, it will be segregated in terms of lessons. So starting off with virtual networks, your network security groups, Azure Firewall, and finally mapping to the DNS services. So even here, if you see, laying down the foundations, securing the access to the contents within the virtual network, right? Whether it is simple through NSGs or NSGs and application security groups, or you can use a complex solution over here like Azure Firewall. And once you are exposing these services or exposing these resources to the end users, you can make use of Azure DNS. Even if you want to work with it internally, you can make use of private DNS over here. Right? So these are the core entities that we have as part of virtual network. Right? And now if you go to deep dive of these resources, so you have virtual networks, respective subnets, right? We can look at implementation of virtual networks. So while we are discussing about each of these things, barring the lab that I mentioned earlier, every module, the SME who is delivering the session, will show you required demonstration over here so that we can understand how these things are working, what are the options over here. Before the lab is being handed over to y'all, y'all should have seen these things working. Now, most of the slides that you'll realize would have proper diagrams, because once it comes to the visual representation of any of these areas, right, it becomes more appealing, it becomes more clear in terms of understanding, and people can relate to their environment, which they have been working on. So in any given scenario, they would have an on-premises environment where they have physical machines, they have physical network, they would have a virtualized environment here, correct? They would have other virtual networks within the same environment or within another cloud platform service provider. Now within Azure, you would go ahead, create a virtual network. You would go ahead, create a subnet over here. And within that subnet, you'll specify your virtual machines. This is basically your network interface card, where the private IP, which is from the given range, will get associated over here. Right? So some of the base resources or base diagrammatic representation would be shown over here. At times, as a trainer, when we are trying to explain any complex aspect, we get stuck because we don't have that kind of diagram being shared by Microsoft. So in those kind of scenarios, what we would do is we would use respective tools, like I'm showing it to you all right now, using draw.io or using Visio, right? And here what we can do is, here we can use set of resources. Appropriate shapes over here, and you all can see there is number of resources from AWS. Right. So while I talk about these things, I can also keep adding set of resources over here. So what I'm creating is a virtual network, and I don't have to speak about it. The diagram itself will show 10.0.0.0/16. What is the range over here? Or what is what is the address space which is being mentioned? Within that virtual network, what are the subnets that we are creating? What is the significance of each of these subnets? What is the range that we are specifying over here? And the visual representation which I'm doing right now we refer it as concept visuals. So for each of these members, we have /16 for the address space on virtual network level. What will be the address space for required members over here? 10.0.1.0/24. n.0.2.0/24. What is the respective subnets over here? So while we are creating these resources, we do mention about the name of subnets. So that participants, so while we speak about these things, they can go ahead and create these resources. So with minimum assistance required from our side, looking at the visual representation, understanding the details being mentioned over here, this is the approach that we take to make sure people understand these resources correctly. And like I said earlier, this is what we refer as concept visuals. Now for each of these subnets, we'll have required virtual machines over here. So what are the number of machines that you would want to create? For app subnet, number of VMs that one would want to create. Okay. Along with this, once it comes to DB subnet, I can have SQL Server virtual machines here. Now, some of these diagrams, we draw it even when we are explaining some of these concepts. A set of interactions. Along with this, at times, if I am not able to locate the shapes, I can directly hop on to what are the options available here. So for web applications, I may go for individual machines, or I can go for virtual machine scale sets. Depending upon if you're looking at containerized applications, non-containerized applications, right? You'll see entire series of options that we have. And this is something that we have, it's not something that we have created. I'm trying to showcase these are some things which we are using as part of our session so that it becomes easier for people to understand. It becomes easier for people to relate to it. But what are the core components over here? How does it work? Right? So the entire process which happens behind the scene is being explained to participants. And with respective labs, they are able to see these things in action. And that's the most important aspect of our environment. I hope this makes sense to everyone. Let me move ahead. Now, some of these concepts, some of these drawings, concept visuals are given by Microsoft. Some of the visuals we create, like I showed you in my environment. As far as subnets are concerned, I just dragged and dropped in the diagram. The significance of these subnets is to make sure we have right set of IP addresses being assigned to our environment, right? And on the subnet level, if you see on the right hand side, you have respective network security groups. Let me show you the implementation here. By going to the networking section. So within networking section, you have number of options for protection over here. Like we mentioned currently. Let me put up respective NSGs over here. Network security group. And we can mention which are the ports that you want to open. Which are the ports that you want to open. So once it comes to database, I'm not sure MS SQL database, which port is required. Anybody who can help me with that? SQL Server database 1433, if I'm not mistaken. Your correct. Application subnet or application NSG, depending upon whether you are working with HTTPS, HTTP. Based on that, you can specify your ports over here. As far as your web applications are concerned, again, port number 443, port number 80. For each NSG, network security group, which are the ports that you want to open over here? Whether they are inbound ports, outbound ports, you can use those symbols over here. Now, while we are drawing this, we are also making sure that once this drawing is complete, we should be able to hand it over to the implementation team, or we should be able to implement it ourselves as well. Right now, that is what is the important aspect over here. So some of these things, while we are discussing, it becomes easier for us to showcase and make sure people are able to create these resources. As far as Azure portal is concerned, so based on the Azure pass being shared with everybody, would be able to log into the Azure portal, create required resources, let's go ahead and let's jump on to virtual network. Let me take up a new resource group over here. Now, once it comes to resource groups. They are very, very important logical. They are very, very important resource for creating logical set of resources within a specific boundary. So when you want to apply any kind of governance, you want to specify any kind of rules, it will become easier for us to work with it. Right? So as far as the name is concerned, let me give it name as Synergetics Virtual Network. Let me specify a region over here as Central India, West India. Whatever you want. And if you recall, this is the range that we had mentioned for address space. As far as subnet is concerned, I'm not sure what is the name which I had given. So if I'm not mistaken, it was web subnet. And while you're creating these kind of subnets, please be careful. It's not only about virtual, it's not only about infrastructure resources. You can also integrate with some of the past resources over here, right? So I may have a website and I want this website to be interacting with machines, which is inside my subnet, inside the web subnet, right? So I can create respective service endpoints over here. Similarly, let me add another subnet over here, which is app subnet. This was .0.1.0/24. For application services or application servers, I would need key vault, I would need service bus. Anything else? Let me choose two of them right now. Similarly, let me add one more subnet over here, which is subnet. And as part of DB subnet, here I would have my range of IP addresses. Service endpoints over here. I can integrate with SQL, I can integrate with storage account, Cosmos DB as well. Right? So depending upon, now this is a, I would say, a bridge between your infrastructure services and platform as service components. So some of these things which I'm showcasing right now is not available as part of the free courses or the documentation that you have as a single example. So what we do during our sessions is we specialize our sessions based on the consulting experience that we have, right? So as part of, I'm not sure if Rupesh had time to mention that. And within 2 hours, if the entire time is taken in terms of introduction, it will be too large. And I would not recommend that as well. So we have our entire consulting team, and every SME who gets into a training also we make sure that he has been through minimum three projects before they start teaching on these topics, because their statements that they make, their suggestions that they make should be more relevant, should be more real life. And that's what differentiates our training. And that's what we, leverage upon from our experience that we have got, right? So like I showed you here itself, you have three subnets over here for a multi-tier application. And each of these members, while I was creating, I have also associated service endpoints over here for relevant services. Let's go ahead, click on security. While I'm doing security, here I can specify DDoS or Azure Firewall service. Now, what is Azure Firewall and how is it different from NSGs in real world scenarios? How do you create network virtual appliance? How do you associate over here? These things will be a most exciting part to learn over here as we go ahead within our sessions. As far as the Bastion is concerned, this is a pre-configured jump box service given by Microsoft, which will help which will help us safely connect to our environment. Okay. Let me proceed ahead. Bastion name, let me give it as Synergetics Bastion. Subnet address space 10.0.3.0. 24 would be too large for this. Even 27 should work, because here we are talking about a single machine. Okay, so we can specify, we should specify a public IP address over here. Let me specify a name for it. As Bastion public IP address. So Bastion basically is a pre-configured jump box service. Once we're done with this, let's go ahead, go to the tags over here. As far as tag is concerned, here I can mention the purpose of creating it. The purpose is demo session for Synergetics. You can have large number of tags over here. In case of initial resources, it is easy for us when I have 5-10 resources or 2-3 virtual machines. It becomes easy for us to remember it, keep a track of it. But as and when the workload keeps increasing, when customer sees the benefits of the cloud platform, you go ahead, start continue creating these resources, right? It will become really, really hectic to remember which machine, which component was created for what purpose, right? And secondly, if it was everything for free, then we don't have to even worry about it. But there will be somebody on top of you who will be asking that, boss, I'm paying for this. Please tell me, what is the purpose of this resource? If it is not required, can I go and delete it? So in these kind of scenarios, it is essential for you to have right meta information. And using this meta information, you will be able to quickly respond to it, saying, yes, I know the purpose of it. This is why it is being created. This will be the tenure or the duration for which this service will be existing, right? And if not required, you know how to deal with it. Believe me on this, every resource that you create, you are paying for it, directly or indirectly. So if there is any unwanted resource, anything that you feel is not relevant, not required, remove it. This might take some time to create the resource. Virtual network is done. What is taking time basically is creation of the Bastion. So this is the range, address space range that we have mentioned, CIDR notation. If you look at respective subnets over here, there are 4 subnets, web subnet. These 3 we had created, and the 4th one we did it for Bastion subnet. If you look at the range of IPs, /24 has, this is slightly confusing, it should have 256 IPs. Why am I seeing 251? Anyone?
Because what private IP reserved.
Thank you very much. So here you can see 5 Azure IPs are being reserved for internal communication, right? So you have total 256 IP addresses, out of which 251 are usable, directly usable, and 5 are reserved addresses. Right? So you can see that details over here. So depending upon how many IPs do you require, you can reduce the range by increasing the number. So 16 will have around 10,000 odd IP addresses, right? Whereas as you keep moving ahead, as you keep increasing the number, the range will keep getting smaller. So here we have 256 IP addresses, out of which 251 are usable IP addresses. Let me stop here. Let me go back, check the resources. Do I have my Bastion service ready? Yes, it is. Let me check the status. No, it's still not ready. No problem. Meanwhile, let's go to the next resource that we discussed about. Sorry, we did not. Once we have the virtual network ready, we have range of private IP addresses, which I just showed you, and then we have public IP addresses. And if you recall, for Bastion, we have a public IP address created. Depending upon your need, you may have a static IP address or you may have a dynamic IP address over here. Let's go to the next section here, which is network security group. I have skipped some of the slides because I already spoke about it. Let's go to network security groups. And the next step that I want to perform over here is ensuring secure communications and making sure only relevant services are being exposed. Only relevant services are being exposed. And when I'm accepting requests from the user, I'm pretty sure what is the service which I want to share, or I want users to initiate within my environment. So depending upon whether it is a HTTP service, SMTP service, FTP service, which services you are exposing to the end user, we'll have to be very, very careful with that. Once it comes to your network security group, you have some of the predefined rules over here. There are 6 predefined rules, 3 inbound security rules and 3 outbound security rules. So whichever rules that you are creating will be over and above these members. Along with that, we also need to mention what is the priority value for it. So lower the priority number, higher is the priority, right? So if you see the max priority values over here, 65,500, which means this is the lowest priority. What is the lowest priority? Deny all inbound, deny all outbound, which means no communication, right? But if you see a lower priority, right, a lower priority number, which is allow communication via load balancer, allow communication between two machines which are VNet, which are in another VNet or within the same virtual network, correct? That is allow VNet inbound. So while we are opening up the ports, we can also mention whether it is an inbound port, inbound communication, outbound communication, what is the source, what is the destination. This is something that we specify as part of network security groups. In the diagram, I have shown network security group on subnet level. You can also specify your network security group on network interface card. But right now I could not do that because I did not have any machines, right? So while I create a machine, then I will get the network interface card. Or I create a network interface card myself by going to the set of resources available here. Keeping the time constraint in mind, let me proceed ahead. Let me create a network security group. As part of network security group, you can specify for each subnet. I already have network RG. Let me go ahead and create 3 NSGs over here. First one is web NSG. Second one, which I would create is and all of them in the same same resource group. And this resource group that you see is owned by your network team. That's why I've given the name as Network RG. So somebody mentioned about role-based access control. I'm sorry, I could not take that question that there itself. Role-based access control, we can specify roles to specific groups within your organization or specific teams within your organization to respective resource groups. I think that is a very valid indication for the purpose of resource groups. Thanks for that. Next, here I would go ahead for app NSG. Review and create. So you see, hardly takes any time in terms of creating these network security groups. And the reason is whatever you are creating will be in terms of rules, which is later. So right now, whatever you have created is actually empty. Empty in sense, there's nothing there, no rules being specified. Let me go for the third one as DBNSG. So I already have three members being created, three network security groups being created. Let me go to WebNSG. And here you all will be able to see inbound security rules, outbound security rules. I have a small doubt over here and I need your help. So while I'm creating these resources, do I need to open up respective ports for SSH and RDP? What do you all recommend? Because if I have virtual machines, I will be doing an RDP here, right? Nachiket says yes. How about others?
Yes.
Vijay also says yes. So anybody who's saying yes is actually sleeping. The reason why I'm saying that is the core purpose of creating Bastion is you don't open up any such ports like RDP or SSH, right? Not to worry. Some of these kind of things will be an eye opener for us. And there are many more such things that we'll be learning as part of this entire process. So when you are creating your resources here, right? What is the source? What is the IP? What is the source? What is the destination here? Which service you want to open? So if you remember my diagram, I've said very clearly, I want to open HTTP, HTTPS. I don't want to open RDP. I don't want to open SSH. Do you remember that? I have clearly mentioned it over here. And the reason for doing this is RDP and SSH ports, these are they should be avoided. I would say learning is okay, but in terms of real world scenarios, never do that. Let's go ahead, click on add. Similarly, whatever outbound security rules that you would want to create, you can do that. Once these rules are being created, you can go ahead and associate this with your respective subnet over here. Okay, so I have a virtual network. I already have a subnet. Within that, I have done the needed association. Second is app NSG. Now see this carefully, everyone. So as far as the source is concerned, and again, this is just an example. I want this to be accessible. I want this to be accessible only from web application or machines within the web application. So here I'll say the source IP address is 10.0.0/24. Destination, any machines, no problem. Service, HTTP, HTTPS, whichever you'd want. Priority can be 100. The reason being, this is another NSG altogether. So if I was creating multiple rules in the same NSG, then I have to take care of the priority. My mistake, I forgot that implementation. Let me go back to WebNSG. And here, let me add one more for HTTPS as well. So here you see the priority is 110. Give the name in whichever way you want. You cannot have two rules with the same priority number within the same NSG. Across NSGs, no problem. Third one I have is DBNSG. So for DBNSG, same way. Source of IP addresses. I'm not sure on this. If I'm not mistaken, this is 10.0.1.0 from application server to database. That's a source IP. Destination, any machine, no problem. Service, MS SQL, can you see this? It already has chosen the port, which is 1433. Put SQL. So while you are working with your resources over here, you can mention which ports you want to open, how do you want this communication to happen, and all this is being done by the relevant team. And in this case, it will be the networking team. So networking team has already created these resources. They have got these members ready so that now the server team can go ahead and start creating required resources for the same. OK. So you may have respective NSG rules or network interface card as well, because within one subnet, there can be multiple machines. So for a specific machine, just one moment, sorry. Sorry, so I was mentioning about NSG effective rules. So there can be number of machines which we have within a given subnet. And for each machine, you can have set of network security groups and specific rules for them. I showed you all the purpose of creating NSGs and how we can go ahead and create these resources over here. And we looked at creation of inbound and outbound rules. Right. So when you're working with these resources, we'll have to make sure we open up right kind of ports for each of these members. We specify appropriate sections over here. Along with this, if I recall correctly, we mentioned about on-premises connectivity. For on-prem connectivity, and there was one more, which is connectivity with other virtual networks. Once it comes to connectivity with other virtual networks, here what we have is VNet peering, which could be a regional VNet peering, or it could be a global VNet peering. So depending upon where you have your second virtual network, based on that, you can have regional or global VNet peering. Once it comes to on-prem environments, here we would have site-to-site connectivity. Here we could have express route connectivity, depending upon what kind of bandwidth you are looking for, what is the kind of reliability that you are looking at. I'm not sure why I'm writing this text here. I already have which for this. I can use an express route over here. For site to site, I don't remember if I have any that. No. I don't know. Good. So I have a site to site VPN image, which I'm using over here just to represent it. So I can have site to site communication. I can have express route with my on-prem environment. If I have a single device over here, or a single device, I can have connectivity available for that as well. Anyone, what will be this connectivity for a single device?
Point to site.
Sorry. Point to site. Thank you very much. Yeah. So here I'll have it implementation. It becomes much more easier for us to understand, discuss, clarify doubts. So if somebody asks me, Oprakash, I'm stuck somewhere. This is the kind of problem that we are facing. The communication is an issue. So once we have this diagram in front of us, it makes us easier to have more fruitful conversation, right? People can explain their doubts clearly. I will be able to understand these things correctly. And obviously, we would be able to understand, okay, this is where the data packets are being stuck. So using Azure Monitor, using Network Watcher, right? It becomes easier for us to find out why it is going wrong or what is the problem and how we can resolve it. So I want to stop with this, take a look at some of the questions, and then hand it over to Rupesh. Rupesh will mention about the session recording. What is the mechanism of making the session recording available to you all? Just give me some time before he takes over and explains that process to you all. Yash has mentioned a very important thing about high availability configuration. Thanks, Yash. So for high availability configurations, we have something called as availability set. Using availability set, yes, correct. I don't know what's wrong with this. So what one can do is, once it comes to web subnet, we already have a virtual machine scale set, right? In this scenario, what I would recommend is, with virtual machine scale set, go ahead with availability groups. As compared to availability sets. Whereas once it comes to your SQL Server implementation, this is where I would recommend go for availability set. Again, let me clarify over here. Replication of data is not responsibility of Microsoft. Replication of data is your responsibility. How both these instances will be synchronized, whether you want to use mirroring, database mirroring, whether you want to use Quorum server, all that would be your responsibility. Microsoft is not responsible for that. Microsoft is responsible for getting for giving you an SLA of hardware or infrastructure availability. Right? I hope that answers the question. Take up another one. This is availability set. My mistake, this is not availability groups, this is availability zone. Link I have already shared. Other links for the meetup community is being shared by Manish. Anyone else, any questions you all have? So I can take up those questions here. As far as DevOps is concerned, just give me a moment. Let me see. We have so as far as Azure DevOps is concerned, Azure DevOps has number of resources within itself, and the primary components are Azure repos, Azure pipelines. Two of them should be good enough for us to discuss right now. So what we can do is, as far as our source code is concerned, we can put up the source code in Azure repository. This is very much similar to your GitHub environment. Right. The second member that you see over here is your Azure pipelines. So as far as Azure pipelines is concerned, Azure pipeline can pick up resources or can trigger based on any kind of code check-ins or code which is being updated or uploaded onto the source code repository. And why are these pipelines here? There are two type of pipelines. One is build pipeline and second is release pipeline. As part of this release pipeline, what we can do is we can help you all publish the content. So whether you want to publish the content within your app services, you want to publish contents within your scale set resources, all these things will be done via release pipelines. If you do get deeper into this entire environment and get certified on this, there is a paper called as AZ-400, where we discuss this entire process of how the resources can be created, how do you integrate or invoke number of services, how do you publish it on a web app. So if you look at Nachiket, if you look at Express Route, there are two ways of implementing it. You have a Express Route as a hardware component which is associated within your on-premises environment when you are setting it up yourself, right? Another approach over here is you can get a connectivity or get the details of it using your telephone service provider. So as part of Synergetics, what we have done is we had connected with Airtel, and from Airtel we got our express route connection. So they are the ones who are handling the hardware component of it. We are managing the device component of it, which is installed within our rack server, and that's how we have got our connections. Nachiket, does it answer your question? Rahul has a very, very important question. Thanks a lot, Rahul. I'm extremely sorry. I missed out that point. As far as both the exams are concerned, AZ-104 and AZ-303, in both of these exams, I had lab section. So around 40 to 50 marks kind of questions approximately was lab based questions where they give you the complete environment, right? That is Azure portal. They specify what tasks they need to you need to perform. You need to go ahead, create those resources there. The task, if I can recall correctly, which was given to me was creating a DNS, a private DNS using PowerShell, right? And which I did that. So as you go ahead, and if you have a lab exam, don't get scared. You will not get the result immediately. It will take some time. If you don't have the lab in your exam, you will get your result immediately, right? But if you have a lab in your exam, it'll say that we will email you the result after some time, right? So don't panic, it's fine. So in some time, say around half an hour or so, you should be able to get your final result. But AZ-104 and AZ-303 or 300, both of these exams have labs. Now, just continuing further with Rahul's question. Any kind of exam questions you all have, any kind of exam details you'd want, you all can go to this link over here and you can get all information. You can get all information over here. So that's all from my side. Thank you very much, everyone. Over to you, Rupesh.
Okay. Thank you so much, Om Prakash sir, for this wonderful session on AZ-104, Microsoft Azure Administrator. So everyone, I just want your 5 minutes attention here. I'll be sharing my screen and quick reminders for you. Some of the quick reminders, I'll be quick here. I hope my screen is visible to all. So quickly, I want to recollect some of the information that I've shared at the start of the webinar. So as we have our next certification webinar, the topic will be on SC900 certification, Introduction to Microsoft Compliance Solutions. That is happening on 14th of August. You all can register for the same. I'll share the link for this webinar's registration in the chat box. A moment, please. Okay, I've shared the link in the chat box. So the next emerging technology webinar that is happening on the Java technology based, it is on 21st of August. So I'll be sharing the registration link for the same again. I've shared it. So yeah, a special announcement for the day. As I've said earlier, your feedbacks are important to us. So do share your feedbacks, and based on these feedbacks, we are going to select 5 lucky winners who are going to get the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers.
So these names will be announced on our social medias also. So you can follow us on social media. Even yeah. Then one more special announcement. There is a special campaign that is running that is going on by the Microsoft. It is based on your LinkedIn profile. I hope that you all are active on LinkedIn. So all you have to do is just update your skills under skills and endorsement section, or you can just update your certification if you have done it recently. And once it is updated, you can just fill your entry through the link and you will be enrolled for this. One lucky winner could win the Microsoft Surface Pro laptop every month. So for registration yourself, you can just update your LinkedIn first, and then I'll be sharing the link in the feedback form. You can check at the last section of the form. Session recording will be shared on the YouTube channel. So do subscribe to our channel. I'll be sharing the link for the same. And once again, for your reference, I'm sharing the feedback form. Thank you so much, everyone. Don't miss to follow our social media channels to get the timely updates. Thank you so much for connecting us. We'll hope to see you in the next session soon. Thank you so much. Have a great weekend, everyone.
Thank you.